Thanks for tuning in today. Please visit NemoursWellBeyond.org to catch all our episodes and sign up for our monthly newsletter. You can also use the voicemail feature on the website to leave a message with your episode ideas or questions. You just might be featured on an upcoming episode of the show. Without further ado, let's go. Well Beyond Medicine.
Welcome to Well Beyond Medicine, the Nemours Children's Health Podcast. Each week, we'll explore anything and everything related to the 80% of child health impacts that occur outside the doctor's office. I'm your host, Carol Vassar, and now that you're here, let's go.
Let's go!
The recent Well Beyond Medicine Day in Orlando saw the Nemours podcast truck on site and ready with microphones open to hear from Nemours associates at all levels, including six members of the Nemours Florida leadership team. Martha McGill, president for Nemours Central Florida. Dr. Daniel Pabreski, chief medical officer. Vonda Sexton, vice president and chief strategy officer. Jacob Horner, Associate Vice President of State External Affairs, Dr. Todd Glass, Division Chief of Emergency Medicine, and Dr. Jared Capoya, Chief Quality and Safety Officer. Of them, we asked three specific questions, eliciting a variety of thought-provoking answers. So in three parts, we bring you, in their words, the Nemours Florida leadership perspective on the barriers and challenges surrounding the social determinants of health and firsthand accounts of patients and families working with Nemours associates to overcome such barriers, both large and small. Part one. We talk a lot about the social determinants of health, those conditions where people are born, live, learn, work, play, worship, and age that affect a wide range of health, functioning, and quality of life outcomes. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, addressing differences in the social determinants of health makes progress toward health equity, a state in which every person has the chance to attain their highest level of health. So when it comes to the social determinants of health, what do the Nemours Florida leaders see as the biggest challenges ahead and the biggest opportunities? We hear first from Dr. Daniel Pabreski.
It's a question that I approach as a pediatric radiologist who really was never familiar with or having to really think about social determinants of health in my everyday work. Now, as CMO here in Central Florida, I have to think about it much more often. To me, the biggest challenge that I see with tackling social determinants of health is the magnitude of the issue. It almost is an elephant that, how does the saying go? You have to take small bites one at a time. But as you tackle these issues one at a time, it sometimes feels like you're not making any difference because they're so enormous. I've had to talk to myself sort of internally and talk to others about the fact that while it may seem like a Mount Everest climb, that every little piece that we're doing ultimately boils down to one child or one family that we're helping. And whether we're helping them here on the medical side, in the hospital or the emergency department, or we're helping a family outside the walls of this hospital, in the end, however large the enormity or the magnitude of the problem, one family, one kid at a time is ultimately, I think, how we're going to tackle this. If there's a child that's ready to go home and all they need is wheelchair, or they need formula, but we can't get them formula, or they can't afford the outpatient medication that they need, can we figure out novel sort of, I like to think of it as MacGyver ways of figuring out how to get these non-medical, more social related type obstacles and make them into opportunities that we can actually solve for them?
I would say among the challenges, and there's many, I think one is ensuring that there's real collaboration among the social agencies. Also, Florida's a haven for retirees, and prioritizing the needs of children as our population ages, especially with state resources, we're finding that to be a significant challenge. And then another challenge that we have been facing, I would say the headwinds for some time, but it could get worse, is our workforce shortages among care providers, particularly our physicians and nurses. I think there's lots of opportunities. One thing that I think we should be very proud of as a society is that the social awareness of this generation that we're experiencing, there's a true desire to help. And I think that's very exciting and something that will help help us get to that next level. And then also, I think the use of technology, Nemours is a pioneer in the use of technology to reach more and more children. And I think that we'll see more of this to come.
Yeah, I think there's a couple. I think one is really trying to understand the populations we serve before they even ever hit our doors. So I think we do a lot of screening once they get here. But I'm wondering, how can we maybe capture that information before they ever get here so we know where to target interventions earlier, either primary or secondary, tertiary prevention efforts, and get into neighborhoods that way. And then I think the opportunity is probably figuring out what payment mechanisms are right so that we can create resource around that.
Looking at it from a community engagement perspective, I think the biggest thing that we all know is that if you take a child out of poverty, you're really, you know, addressing the root cause of what impacts healthcare. So our community engagement team here at Nemours, we're starting to look at kind of four key principles for how we're going to be looking at partnering with our community resources. So housing, food insecurity, early learning, and then economic development and pipeline growth are going to be the key four areas that you'll look to see Nemours continue to steer into to keep kids out of the doctor's office and get them healthy to become productive adults. I say to a lot of folks, pediatrics is prevention. In doing so, we need to be focusing on those social barriers that keep kids from being healthy, things like housing or food insecurity. Those are our greatest needs right now as we look at that. And then another barrier is also just going to continue to be behavioral health. Behavioral health is such an important pandemic that we're in right now as we think through the COVID-19 impact and the pandemic, what it's done to the well-being of our children and our respective communities. So it's definitely going to be a focal area for our system as we get to address that head on.
I think the challenges are structural and social. And maybe it sounds like a cliche, but institutionalized isms, you know, classism, economicism, racism, languageism, all those kinds of things that make us look at another chunk of society as something other than we are. And that leads to access issues and stability issues for families. Just speaking from personal experience, when I was young, my mother was a single mother in the 60s. We lived in a tenement and in the projects in a city in the South. I went to the health department for health care, went to the food bank for food, all those kinds of things. So I was subject to a little classism, right? And then what really led to the change was economic stability. My mother remarried, and that moved us to a different economic stratum, which allowed access to better education and all those other kinds of things. Plus, I'm a white guy from the South, not a black guy from the South. So that stuff exists. And because that stuff exists as part of our institutions, people seeing through some lens that's preset in their head, organizations seeing through some lens that's preset in their structure, the changes to make to even the playing field had to be structural changes. How do we build systems that are broad-based, that provide emotional and mental health support so that families become socially stable internally, and economic support so they become culturally stable broadly, that allows them really access to the basic things that they need in healthcare? And that leads to generational stability. That's the big opportunity. It's probably some kind of public-private partnership to establish broad-based services that are accessible, sort of blind to all those isms, and that is somehow functionally naive to economics. And what I mean by that is you don't have to worry about the money so much because the services are funded in a sustainable way. That's why I say it's probably a public-private partnership. Is it the risk proposition with Medicaid-funded managed care plans and healthcare systems that can partner with them to assume responsibility for a large population, basically the kids that don't have all those accesses, and then they can build mental health services for families, job services for families, educational opportunities for families and kids, all those kinds of things that then drive to lifting them up to some extent so that the kids then, that's my perspective, right, the kids have the best health they can have, which allows them to succeed as well as they can, which allows them to provide a foundation for their kids and for their kids and for their kids.
Currently, there are 4.2 million children in Florida, and more are moving to the state every day. And so that means there's a lot of children to care for. I believe that there's fragmented care around resources that are available for the children, and we really have to figure out how to facilitate and address those challenges. I believe Nemours can be a facilitator for these children. We can address those needs. So I mentioned that there's fragmentation amongst the resources. There's a lot of people, a lot of organizations that want to help. But how do we come together and bring those resources to the families and the children that need them? So I see Nemours as really a convener of those resources.
Part 2. What barriers have these Nemours Florida leaders seen firsthand among patients and their families that prevent these patients and families from obtaining that full potential in terms of health and well-being? First up, Jared Capoya.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think from a quality perspective, one of the things I think about a lot is we have a lot of families who have complex health needs or complex medical needs, and I don't know that all of them know how to navigate a complex healthcare system very well. And so I think, however, we can help them understand whether it's the sequence of visits or when they need to see what doctor and what resources they need, what home health needs they need, what, you know, durable medical equipment, things like that, that they need, that the more we can assist them and create equitable access to the doctors and the resources, clinicians they need. I think that's one big barrier that I see out there. The other one that I think of, and I think of this because I'm in quality, obviously, and we look at a lot of outcomes, a lot of measures, and many of those are healthcare centric. We create them. We don't always look from the patient side and say, what are those patient centric outcomes or those, what matters to them, what matters to the people we're taking care of, and create outcomes around that and sort of balance it out.
Being fairly new to my role, I have been shocked at how the simplest, littlest things can create barriers for kids to grow up to their full potential. Things as simple as transportation to get to the doctor's appointment, food, clean air, clean water, understanding the instructions that they're being given by a healthcare provider, you know, if language is a barrier. But every one of those little things, even here on the hospital side, when a child is ready to be discharged from a medical perspective, we often find out about all of these social or non-medical issues that prevent the family from either being able to get the equipment, the medicine, the formula that they need for various reasons. Sometimes it's as simple as there's nobody that can get here to pick the child up to go home. So I think, you know, sometimes we think these are huge issues like we need clean air or we need people to have food for lunch at school. But sometimes it's as simple as this child is ready to go home. We have fixed whatever medical issue is going on and we can't find someone who can get here to the hospital and pick the child up and take them home. So it's small things, it's big things, but for each of these kids and family, they're all as equally as important.
One of the barriers, and I experienced this firsthand as a mother of a child with a complex medical situation, is navigating the complex medical healthcare system. As we've all experienced, is not only is it complex, it's fragmented. Additionally, I would say we're seeing the reality of the impact of the economic inflationary pressures on our families. We were seeing unstable, fragmented families with complex social situations, and we're trying to address all of this.
I think one of the beauties of my role is I get to talk to the community. I hear from legislators, I hear from regulators and, you know, other community leaders. And so many people will stop me and say, you saved my child. There's also folks who will stop me and say, hey, we just had this experience and, you know, there's some lessons learned. One of those recent examples, a little girl with asthma, and let's call her Sally. So Sally was coming to Nemours once a month, having respiratory, you know, breathing issues. We found out that she was in a house that wasn't the most up to date with code, actually stemmed from air conditioning unit challenges. And, you know, we were able to work with her to get her the resources that were needed to retrofit their home. We haven't seen her except in primary care since. That was a really positive success story. What we're doing is we're beginning to embed social determinants of healthcare screeners within our primary care and urgent cares, which are allowing us to really try to identify those problems head on and then working with community partners. So United Way, their 211 program, to be able to connect the dots and then a closed loop referral to be able to actually follow up with those patients afterwards.
So what I see really tags on to what Martha and Jacob have shared. For the last 10 years since our hospital opened, we have really gone out and looked at some of these underserved markets where there wasn't access to a pulmonologist or to care, and bring that care to the families, to that community, and care for more children so they don't show up in the ED or worse, don't get care. So increasing access in the community has been key to our success here in Central Florida. And we see it over and over again, the families that now don't have to drive an hour or worse, that they may not have received the care, that we're offering that right there in the community.
Part 3. How do the departments headed by these Nemours Florida leaders demonstrate going well beyond medicine to create the healthiest generations of children? Once again, Dr. Daniel Podbereski.
So I think we do it every day. I've been really amazed, and I feel an immense sense of pride knowing that we have a ton of people on the team here in Central Florida, Nemours, whose passion is tackling these issues. And again, I mean, it can be things as complex as a mobile clinic, which Dr. Laura Chilcutt and we have several nurses and the residents participate in that endeavor. And those are complex. You need a truck, you need supplies, you got to figure out where you're going, how do you document everything, to things as simple as someone told me the story the other day of a family, again, back to transportation, that was having an issue transportation-wise. And we have team members that figure it out, sometimes pitching in from their own resources to help families out in small but extremely meaningful ways. And really, we see it every day. We celebrate it at our huddles. We talk about it. We use something called Connect to Purpose at many of our meetings, where we talk about why do we all do what we really do. And lots of the examples of Connect to Purpose, while a lot of them are medical, like someone saved someone's life by finding a tumor very early. I mean, those are obviously very meaningful as well. But a lot of the Connect to Purposes that are shared at forums and meetings here in the building come back to just social type issues, figuring out a way to ensure that, you know, a child who may be in a difficult social situation gets some toys, or, you know, connects up with our in-house school program. I mean, little things like that that I think just differentiate us a little bit from some of our partners around the state or even the country that maybe don't have as broad and as diverse of a perspective on pediatric health.
My team really does actually reach out into the community, to the providers. So if you look at the pediatricians, really that primary care pediatricians really do actually see these children. And so what we're trying to do is make sure that the pediatricians are armed with the information they need on what's available. If we are the convener of some of these resources, what's available, we also can make sure that that's available to the pediatricians to be able to share with the families. So I think as we continue to see that growth, making sure that we, again, know those resources are available for those families.
I think, again, in quality and safety, one of the things that I like to talk about, especially with the team, is that we're there to help create health, that we're there to, you know, around the vision of creating the healthiest generations of children, that we're there to improve and push child health. So I like the, I don't know if you've ever heard of the World Health Organization definition of health, that it talks about physical health, mental health, and social well-being. It also talks about that it doesn't mean that somebody doesn't have a condition, but that they could be healthy if we address all three of those things. So I think that's something, again, that when we look at the quality of care, we can look in all three of those areas, and then also look at disparities or inequities where there may be opportunities that certain populations are not getting that others are. And we can look at our data and through those lenses so that we can see where do we need to focus effort or where do we need to intervene so that everybody has sort of an equitable playing field to the same outcome.
I have the good fortune of getting a chance to work, you know, across our four state capitals in both the Delaware Valley and in Florida, to work with lawmakers to ensure that they understand, You know, some of the challenges that are impacting pediatrics, we've talked a lot about, you know, prevention. We've got to continue to look at how we think about taking care of our really vulnerable children and ensuring that both we have access, we have enough providers that are going to be, you know, there to take care of those kids, and that those children are using their primary care to create patient-centered family medical homes rather than, again, using, you know, the ICU and the ER. It's unfortunately a very cyclical process. And as our hospital sees a little over 70% Medicaid on a given year. So we are talking about children that often have medical complexities, but, you know, may be underserved. So working through that is a great opportunity, but also presents challenges as well. We have an incredible community engagement team here at Nemours, and both the power of our associates using, you know, the volunteer time off that we do to work with our partners in the community so that they understand the power of Nemours in both our clinical opportunities and then for our allied associates to be able to give their time in the community is huge. But identifying those partners who, you know, may be cutting edge in research that is going to help kids in Central Florida, in Jacksonville, Pensacola, and in Delaware Valley, but also just working with those groups that are doing a lot in the social determinants of healthcare to create those supports to help our patients is huge.
One of the things I'm most proud of is how we meet families where they are, whether it's Vonda's team, making sure we're out in the community, keeping, you know, the children of Polk County in Polk County, or if it's, you know, one of the primary care providers, keeping the children there at that primary care clinic that is the medical home that Jacob spoke about, that does have behavioral health embedded in that facility. And also using, again, back to technology, making sure that we are using our telemedicine resources so that we can meet the children and families where they are. But I also want to emphasize that I think a wonderful way that we go well beyond medicine every day, when you walk the halls of this hospital, you see our care team going the extra mile day in and day out to really understand the details of every single child and their needs and making sure that whatever it takes to take care of that child while they're here, and also to make sure they have a nice landing with their transition to home, you see our care providers making sure that that gap is met.
There's really two things. One is the team cares. And what I mean by that is they're individually and personally aware of things that, you know, drive healthcare and successful healthcare for kids. So when kids come into the ED, they're aware of language issues. They're aware of economic issues. They see something and they do something. Like a kid, if there's a communication issue, then we would look to use the resources that we already have to kind of bring them on board. We build systems to get those services to kids. If we can tell that they don't have a good primary care provider or any primary care provider, we have handouts and we give information. If it looks really like there's a real tenuous family, we'll call our social worker down. And social worker will work to connect them to public services that are available in the community. But it's really all triggered by the fact that the team cares. And when they see something, they try to do something in real time. And remember, that's in the context of emergency department visit. So it's not longitudinal care. It's episodic care. And we have a couple hours. So we do what we can. But if you go just one step deeper, we developed some initiatives that are a little more system-based. Like one of my team members is working with the program to develop discharge instructions that are in Spanish. We're in Orlando. A lot of people speak Spanish, and most of our discharge instructions are in English. We work with our official translators to translate, but we also have staff members who will help us, and the nurses who speak Spanish will reiterate the directions that I've given through the translator in Spanish when they see the kid go home. We work on programs around human trafficking awareness, and we have, you know, triggers with educate on those signs to look for. We have an abuse and neglect pathway, which, you know, leads, you know, that's a lot of time based on family chaos. So a lot of social and economic instability is kind of a driver of that kind of stuff. We have screenings built into our chart to look at the drivers of those kinds of things. A lot of stuff like that are system based. What I think is really probably most important, individuals within the team do their own. For instance, we have providers who work at Shepherd's Hill, a local service program for primary care. Right? We have couple of providers and other staff members who volunteer at a small orphanage down the street from us. We have people that do things like that, which shows that they have the heart, and then they come to work and they bring that awareness and they help us drive programs and initiatives. And when they see a kid or a family in need, they try to hoof them up to the right services in real time.
Dr. Todd Glass on how his team is working toward the healthiest generations of children. Ahead of Dr. Glass, we heard from Jacob Horner, Martha McGill, Dr. Jared Capoya, Vonda Sexton, and, at the top, Dr. Daniel Podbereski, all of whom stopped by the Well Beyond Medicine podcast truck last month in Orlando. We thank them for their time, inspiration, and insights.
Well Beyond Medicine.
The Well Beyond Medicine podcast truck is coming to Jacksonville, Florida on October 5th as we celebrate Well Beyond Medicine Day there. That's your opportunity to stop by, say hi, and chat on the record on what Well Beyond Medicine means to you and bring us your episode ideas for the future. Can't make it to Jacksonville? Head on over to our website, nemourswellbeyond.org, and leave us a voicemail with your thoughts on Well Beyond Medicine, the concept, and the podcast. We'd especially love to hear your feedback and ideas for upcoming episodes. While you're there, check out our other episodes and subscribe to the podcast. Thanks to Che Parker and Susan Masucci for their help with producing today's podcast, with special kudos to Cheryl Munn, who gathered today's audio. I'm Carol Vassar. Join us next time as we talk about maintaining the emotional well-being of children with chronic illnesses. Until then, remember, together we can change children's health for good, well beyond medicine.
Let's go!